Dear students, this is a lecture on gingival enlargement. I am Dr. Rajkumar, assistant professor and head of the department of periodontics, Penang International Dental College. So this class talks about the basics of classification of gingival enlargement and the pathogenesis of gingival enlargement. So this lecture I am going to talk only about the classification and pathogenesis of gingival enlargement. The learning outcomes for these topics are: define gingival enlargement, list 5 major reasons for gingival enlargement, explain in detail about the pathogenesis involved in gingival enlargement, and differentiate various types of gingival enlargement. Coming on to the classification, gingival enlargement have been classified based on the location and distribution into localized gingival enlargement, generalized gingival enlargement, marginal gingival enlargement, papillary gingival enlargement, diffuse enlargement, or a discrete enlargement. So what is localized? Localized classified based on the number of tooth involved. It limits to the gingiva adjacent to a single tooth or a group of teeth is called as localized gingival enlargement, whereas generalized involves the gingiva throughout the mouth. Marginal gingival enlargement confines only to the marginal gingiva, and papillary involvement confines only to the interdental papilla, whereas diffuse gingival enlargement involves marginal gingiva, interdental papilla, as well as the attached gingiva. When all three parts of the gingiva is involved, it is called as diffuse gingival enlargement. The final is discrete, when there is an isolated, sessile or pedunculated enlargement seen, it is classified as discrete gingival enlargement. This is one type of classification. Another is based on the etiology and pathogenesis. The gingival enlargement have been classified into inflammatory gingival enlargement, drug-induced gingival enlargement, gingival enlargement associated with systemic disease or conditions, neoplastic enlargement, and false enlargement. Again, these 5 types of enlargement have been subdivided into, the inflammatory is subdivided into acute and chronic inflammatory gingival enlargement. The drug induced is further subclassified based on the type of the drug which is going to induce the enlargement into anticonvulsant, immunosuppressant, and calcium channel blockers. Associated with systemic disease or condition is further divided into conditioned gingival enlargement, systemic disease causing gingival enlargement. The examples for conditioned gingival enlargement are pregnancy gingival enlargement, puberty gingival enlargement, plasma cell gingivitis, and non-specific conditional enlargement like pyogenic granuloma. Whereas the systemic disease causing enlargement are further classified into leukemia, granulomatous disease, are some of the examples of systemic disease causing gingival enlargement. The neoplastic gingival enlargement have been subclassified into benign or malignant enlargement. Finally, the false enlargement. We'll see one by one. Before that, we'll see about the grading of gingival enlargement. This is classification of gingival enlargement. Then we'll go on for grading of gingival enlargement. Basically, the gingival enlargement is graded into 3 grades. Grade 0, there is no sign of gingival enlargement. Grade 1, enlargement confines to the interdental papilla. Grade 2, enlargement involving interdental papilla and marginal gingiva. Grade 3, when the enlargement covers 3/4 or more of the crown part, it is classified as grade 3. So we'll see one by one what are all the types of gingival enlargement based on the etiology and pathogenesis. We'll start with inflammatory gingival enlargement. It is result from a chronic or acute inflammatory changes. It's purely inflammatory caused by the local factors. So the chronic inflammatory gingival enlargement, the clinical features will be arginate as a slight ballooning of the interdental papilla and marginal gingiva. Early stages, it produces a life preserved shaped bulge around the involved tooth. It progresses very slowly and painlessly. It may be a localized enlargement or a generalized enlargement. The etiology for chronic inflammatory gingival enlargement is due to the prolonged exposure of dental plaque, often seen in patients with habit of mouth breathing. So these are the pictures of an inflammatory gingival enlargement. You can see only the interdental papilla and some part of the marginal gingiva is involved and not involving the attached gingiva. Most of the time it involves the interdental papilla and marginal gingiva. So gingival changes associated with mouth breathers. The gingiva will be red, edematous, diffuse surface shininess of the exposed area, most frequently seen in the maxillary anterior region, which is due to the exposure of oral cavity onto the external environment due to the mouth breathing habit. So basically this type of gingival enlargement happens because of exposure to the external environment. The gingiva become dry and it got inflamed. Once the inflammation starts, it increases vascularity and result in inflammatory enlargement, which is basically because of the increased vascularity, there will be more blood vessels coming there, more amount of venous stasis happens there, which results in bulging of the gingiva. That is why it is called as inflammatory gingival enlargement. The next is acute type of inflammatory gingival enlargement. Acute gingival enlargement, the example is gingival abscess. It may be localized, painful and rapidly expanding lesion. There will be a sudden onset which will be less than 48 hours. The fluctuant and pointed with a surface orifice from which a purulent exudate may be expressed and it ruptures spontaneously. So it is a type of gingival enlargement, basically a gingival abscess which is caused maybe due to a local factor or an external factor like a fish bone injury. When a fish bone or any hard particle stuck on the gingival margin, there will be inflammatory reaction. Once there is an inflammatory reaction, unless until that local factor is removed, it will result in formation of pus. Basically the pus formation result in enlargement of the gingiva in that localized region. That is acute gingival enlargement. The second type of gingival enlargement is drug-induced gingival enlargement. I already told that there are different subclasses of drug-induced gingival enlargement based on the type of drug used. So basically the drug-induced gingival enlargement is classified into anticonvulsant, immunosuppressants and calcium channel blockers. The clinical features of a drug-induced enlargement are usually painless, bead-like enlargement of the interdental papilla. Marginal and papillary enlargements are most frequently seen. The lesion is mulberry-shaped, firm, pale pink and resilient. Minutely lobulated surface and no tendency of bleeding. It is not happens in edentulous space because the drug alone will not cause enlargement. So it requires a local factors for the enlargement to happen. So it requires plaque. So in an edentulous patient, there will not be any plaque. So there will not be any gingival enlargement in edentulous space. But in dentated space, you will see enlargement due to the drug. Or genetic predisposition is suspected factor. And this type of gingival enlargement are chronic and it will slowly increase in size. So this is a picture of drug induced gingival enlargement. You can see the difference between a drug induced and inflammatory. Inflammatory will be more reddish, bleeds spontaneously, and it will be more inflamed, whereas drug induced will not have that much of inflammation and it will not be reddish. We'll go on to one by one each and every drug. So start with anticonvulsant drug. The most frequently seen gingival enlargement drug is phenytoin sodium. The other drugs are like ethidoine, mefitoin, succinamide also can cause gingival enlargement. So 50% of the patient receiving these type of drugs are expected to get gingival enlargement. It is not related to the dosage of the drug, but it relates to the duration of usage of the drug. Longer the duration of the drug usage, more chances of getting the enlargement. The reason is phenytoin stimulate the proliferation of fibroblast like cells and epithelium. So these fibroblast like cells multiplies and forms collagen. So there will be more amount of collagen, the ground substance, going to increase in the gingiva, which results in enlargement. And phenytoin also do one more thing called, it produces the product called inactive fibroblastic collagenase. Basically collagenase or substance which is going to break down collagen, so that excess collagen whatever formed will be break down and removed from the place. But what phenytoin do is it produces an inactive fibroblastic collagenase, where these collagenase are ineffective in breaking down the collagen. So the collagen degradation decreases, whereas the fibroblast like cells increases the proliferation of collagen. So one side there is increased amount of collagen deposition, the other side the collagen breakdown is not happening, which results in enlargement. That is how anticonvulsant produce gingival enlargement. The next drug is immunosuppressants. Immunosuppressant, the example of the drug is cyclosporine. This is a dose dependent drug, whereas phenytoin is a non-dose dependent drug. It is the duration dependent drug. Longer the duration we use, most possible of getting the enlargement. Whereas immunosuppressant, higher the dose, there are more chances of getting gingival enlargement. So cyclosporine, dosage greater than 500 milligrams per day can induce gingival enlargement. So there will be more vascularization and affects children's more frequently. Next drug is calcium channel blockers. This drug developed for the treatment of cardiovascular conditions such as hypertension, angina pectoris, coronary artery spasms and cardiac arrhythmia. The example is amilodipine. Other drugs like felodipine and nicardipine also can cause gingival enlargement. So these calcium channel blockers have a possibility of inducing gingival enlargement in 20% of the individuals who are taking the calcium channel blockers. So the most frequent drug is nifedipine, which induces 20% of gingival enlargement. Other drugs like diltiazem, fludipine, nitrodipine and verapamil can also induce enlargement. Next is idiopathic gingival enlargement. Other terms called gingivostomatitis, elephantiasis, idiopathic fibromatosis, hereditary gingival hyperplasia and congenital familial fibromatosis. It affects the attached gingiva, whereas previously whatever we have seen, it attacks most frequently the marginal gingiva and interdental papilla. Whereas this idiopathic gingival enlargement affects the attached gingiva first, then it proceeds to marginal gingiva and interdental papilla. So the clinical features will be, it will be pink, firm and almost leathery in consistency and minutely pebbled surface. In tuberous sclerosis, the triad of epilepsy, mental deficiency and cutaneous angiofibromas can be seen along with gingival enlargement. So it is a picture of idiopathic gingival enlargement. The next classification of gingival enlargement is associated with systemic diseases. So systemic diseases, there are different systemic diseases, condition, enlargement and induced by systemic diseases. The two different mechanisms are magnification of an existing inflammation initiated by the dental plaque or manifestation of the systemic disease independently of the inflammatory status of the gingiva. These are the two different mechanisms where systemic disease can associated with gingival enlargement. First, we'll see about the magnification of an existing inflammation in the gingiva. So the examples are pregnancy gingival enlargement, puberty gingival enlargement, nutritional disease such as vitamin D deficiency and conditional enlargement. The other part is manifestation of the systemic disease independent of inflammation. There is no need for any local factors to be present or inflammation to be present. The examples are systemic diseases and neoplastic diseases where it doesn't require any local environment to induce gingival enlargement. So we'll see about conditioned enlargement. So conditioned enlargement, basically the systemic condition of the patient exaggerate the normal inflammatory response in the gingival tissue. Basically the bacterial plaque, when it present, the gingiva respond to the bacterial plaque by inducing inflammation. Whereas what happens during this condition enlargement, the systemic condition of the patient, for example, if the patient is having pregnancy, puberty, there will be changes in the hormonal levels. These hormonal levels will increase in the blood circulation. When these hormones are increased, what will happen there is that the dental plaque, instead of taking the food what it usually takes, the proteins what it requires for its growth, it compensated with the hormones. So it takes hormones as the food and it grows faster. So it results in bacterial plaque which grows faster and induce more inflammation. So the bacterial plaque is necessary to initiate this type of enlargement. Since the plaque substitute the hormones and nutrients for the growth of the plaque, this will result in increased inflammation. Once there is increased inflammation, more venostasis happens, more blood vessels engages and increases in the size of the gingiva. It is more towards like a inflammatory gingival enlargement, but it is aggravated by the systemic disease, right? So enlargement in pregnancy, so there are two types. It may be a localized or a generalized. Most frequently marginal gingiva is involved. Generalized or may occur in single or multiple tumor like masses. Hormonal changes induce changes in vascular permeability leading to gingival edema and an increased inflammatory response to the dental plaque. So most frequently the microorganism responsible for this is Prevotella intermedia. The marginal enlargement, aggravation of the previous inflammation, usually generalized, prominent interproximally, and it will be bright red to magenta in color, soft and friable and smooth and shiny surface, bleed on spontaneously. So it is almost have the clinical features same like the inflammatory gingival enlargement. The other type of gingival enlargement you will see in pregnancy is tumor like enlargement, or otherwise called as a pyogenic granulomal type of enlargement, which is pregnancy tumor. It is not a neoplastic tumor, but because of the local factor in a single tooth, it induces the gingival enlargement, a localized abscess type of enlargement in that specific tooth alone. So again, since it is an inflammatory type of enlargement, the clinical features will be more or similar towards the inflammatory type of gingival enlargement. So this is a picture of generalized gingival enlargement during pregnancy and a pregnancy tumor seen on premolars. Next is enlargement in puberty. It occurs both in males and females during the adolescent age. It is again a marginal and interdental papillary type of gingival enlargement. The facial gingiva are enlarged. Clinical features generally associated with the chronic inflammatory gingival enlargement. So after puberty, the gingival enlargement undergoes spontaneous reductions after the plaque and calculus have been removed. Again, this is due to the variation in the hormonal levels during puberty, which results in the gingival enlargement. So once the patient crosses the puberty, the hormonal balance will come in place. Once the hormones are balanced, this type of gingival enlargement will regress by itself, provided we remove the local factors from the site. Next is enlargement associated with vitamin C deficiency. Again, this is a type of inflammatory enlargement. It's seen in marginal gingiva. The gingiva is bluish red, soft and friable, and has a smooth, shiny surface. Hemorrhage occurs either spontaneously or on a slight provocation, and surface necrosis with pseudomembrane formation are common features for this vitamin C deficiency gingival enlargement. Next is plasma cell gingivitis. It is mild marginal gingival enlargement, extend to the attached gingiva, appears red, friable, and sometimes granular and bleeds easily. Does not induce or loss of attachment. The oral aspect of the attached gingiva is more involved. The next part of conditioned enlargement is pyogenic granuloma. It is a tumor-like gingival enlargement that is considered as an exaggerated conditional response to minor trauma. In case of pregnancy, we will call it as pregnancy tumor. We will not call it as pyogenic granuloma, but it almost looks like a pregnancy tumor. The gingival enlargement is almost similar to in clinical as well as in microscopic appearance to the pregnancy tumor. The only difference between pyogenic granuloma and pregnancy tumor is the patient is not pregnant in pyogenic granuloma. If the patient is pregnant and the same clinical findings are seen, then it is pregnancy tumor or pregnancy gingival enlargement. Right? If the patient is not pregnant, it is not due to the specific hormone which induced the enlargements, then it is classified as pyogenic granuloma. Then systemic disease causing enlargement. Here the systemic disease by itself can cause the enlargement. It doesn't require any local factors for the enlargement to happen. Any local factor or inflammation to be present to for the enlargement to happen. That is basically it is independent of local inflammatory response. So the leukemia is an example, whereas diffuse or marginal, and it may be localized or generalized type of enlargement. Diffuse enlargement of the gingival mucosa and oversized extensions of the marginal gingiva under a discrete tumor like interproximal masses can be seen. It will be bluish red in color and shiny surface, moderately firm. Hemorrhage occurs either spontaneously or on slight irritation. Acute painful necrotizing ulcerative inflammation involvement may occur at the tooth gingival junction. So it is a picture of leukemia patient. Next is neoplastic type of gingival enlargement. Again, this is independent of the inflammatory response to the local site. It may be benign or malignant tumors. So the example of benign is epulis. which is a generic term used clinically to designate a discrete tumor or tumor-like mass of the gingiva. So the examples are fibroma, papilloma, peripheral giant cell granuloma, central giant cell granuloma, leukoplakia, gingival cyst, and other benign masses. So when it comes to malignancy, malignant tumors like carcinomas, malignant melanoma, sarcoma, metastasis are seen in gingival, which results in neoplastic gingival enlargement. The final part is the false enlargement. False enlargement, it is basically not due to the enlargement of the gingiva, but it is either due to the underlying bone or the underlying dental tissue which showcase the as a gingival enlargement. But basically there is no enlargement in the gingiva. It is the increase in the size or the mass of the bone or the protruding tooth, the malpositioning of the tooth, which results shows as an gingival enlargement, which is called as false enlargement. So enlargement of the bone subject to the gingival area occurs most often in the exostosis or tore, occurs in Paget's disease, fibrous dysplasia, cherubism, central giant cell granuloma, ameloblastoma, osteoma and osteosarcoma. Underlying dental tissues, during eruption of the primary dentition, the labial gingiva may show a bulbous marginal distortion. It is caused by superimposition of a bulk of the gingiva on the normal prominence of the enamel in the gingival of the crown. So it is basically not a gingival enlargement, but because of the crown or the tooth which is protruding into the gingiva. Okay, this is the basic classification and pathogenesis of gingival enlargement. The treatment part we'll dealt with a separate lecture class. Thank you.